Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Entrepreneurship 101. This is session two. Hi, I'm Debbie Williams, and I am the chairman of Target 3, Building Your Economic Legacy. And on behalf of my co-chairman, Lakeisha Dancy, and our vice president, Tasha Smith, again, I'd like to welcome you. If you missed session one, I encourage you to go to our YouTube channel, Chi Omega Omega, and check it out. It was something else, and we plan for this one to be just as great. But before I turn it over to our amazing lead for this event, who has worked tirelessly for session one and session two, and we hope you join us for session three and session four, which she is already working on, we would like to bring to the camera our president of the Imani Pearls Community Development Foundation, Brandy Gears. Brandy, would you like to say a few words?
Hi, thank you so much. I just wanted to greet everyone this morning and say that I'm really excited to welcome and be in the presence of both Carol Harris and John Griffin Jr. and Dr. Denitra Griffin. I'm excited that our guests will get the opportunity to receive such valuable information and nuggets. And on a personal level, I'm super excited because I have a very, very, very small business. And I'm excited to prayerfully, and I use those words with intent and purpose, to push my small business in new and innovative ways. So I did want to leave you guys with a quote that I found to be very interesting about just business and being successful. And it is, if you wake up deciding what you want to give versus what you want to get, you will become a more successful person. So this morning, I'm excited for the committees that have worked on this, and I'm excited for our presenters, and I'm super excited about being able to give so that I can get. And I think that's what our foundation and our chapter was based on. So thank you for allowing me to speak, and good morning. I'm excited for the program.
Thank you, President Garris. Now, without further ado, we are going to get started with our workshop. Sit back, grab a cup of coffee, grab some water, whatever it is that you need, and enjoy everything that you're about to learn and about to hear. It is going to be an absolutely amazing. So Alexia, would you like to take over?
Great. Thank you, Debbie. Good morning, everyone. I am so thrilled to have each of you here with us today for part two of the Rebuild Black Wall Street series. As with any new year, right, and as we kick off 2022, people start to, you know, see how they can do better, right? They want to do new things differently to see better results. But often they don't know how to get started or keep up the momentum as the year progresses. So during our time today, we are going to tackle just that. We're going to provide you with sound advice from some knowledgeable sources to kickstart you and your business in high gear. So get ready to launch forward. According to data from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, about 20% of U.S. small businesses fail within the first year. By the end of their fifth year, roughly 50% have faltered. And after 10 years, only around a third of businesses have survived. Businesses die for a variety of reasons. Owners face financial constraints, workforce or talent issues, lack of demand for their product or service, or even burnout. The list goes on and on. And all too often, though, the cause is that entrepreneurs forego developing a sound business plan. They have big ideas and jump right in before gaining a thorough understanding of what their business can offer, which our session focuses on helping you avoid those pitfalls. Next slide, please. Next slide, please, again. Before we dive into session two, let's recap session one, Entrepreneurship 101. During that lively discussion, we talked about the five types of business entities and requirements to start, including IRS filing requirements. We also talked about who you need on your dream team, an attorney, a CPA, a payroll provider, and bingo, a business plan developer. We also talked about you having a vision, a plan, and work ethic in order to make sure that you are moving forward, and also establishing your why. The road is going to get rough, but why are you still going to stay in the game so you can create multiple streams of income to build generational wealth and close the racial wealth gap? And I hope you completed your homework. Next slide, please. Our presenters today, I am so thrilled and honored to have with us to provide you with their knowledge and expertise on the topic of business plans. You'll also hear an unconventional pathway into entrepreneurship. First up, we have Carol Harris, who is the lead economic development specialist from the U.S. Small Business Administration, and John Griffin Jr., CEO, and Dr. Denitra Griffin, president of AGB Innovative Security Solutions. So what I would like to do now to bring first to the virtual stage is Carol Harris. Next slide, please. Carol Harris is the lead economic development specialist for the U.S. Small Business Administration's Illinois District Office. If you didn't know, the SBA provides advocacy, business, contracting, economic, financial, and technical assistance to small businesses. Ms. Harris is a project manager with experience in auditing, lending, and underwriting loans, portfolio management, and government contracting. Carol is the project manager for SBA's Funded Resource Partners and leads the economic development team in Illinois. Carol graduated with honors from the University of Illinois at Chicago with a degree in accounting. She is a certified public accountant, certified government financial manager, 2013 Chicago REAP graduate, master gardener, and beekeeper. Wow, what a resume. So without further ado, please welcome Carol Harris. Carol, please take it away.
Okay. Share my screen. Okay. Hopefully everyone can see the screen. And the other thing is I'm going to stop my video. Okay. So good morning to everyone. And thank you for the opportunity to be able to speak. I wanna basically bring greetings and thank the officers, the leadership, the members of Kyomeka Omega Chapter, the Associated Imani Pearls CDC, and to everyone that's listening in, to family, friends, and small business owners and wannabes. We basically want to begin to talk about and take a look at SBA resources. So I'm gonna center my screen and start the journey. So whether you aspire to small business ownership, if you own a business, if you're seeking to grow your sales and or services, SBA provides a lot of resources and information. We're a federal agency, and we're going to begin to talk about some aspects of your why. Now, being a creative person at heart, I'm hopeful that this presentation will weave together this slide deck. I'm going to share a few wow points related to African-American ownership and small business resources. And we're going to look to very quickly address some of the whys. And I'm also going to share some nuggets of information and leave a couple of resources for you to follow up on. It sounds like the cohort has some homework. So what SBA seeks to do as a federal agency is to ignite change and to spark action so that small businesses can confidently start, grow, expand, and recover if there happens to be a disaster. And the point of sharing this information is basically to increase your confidence in your business smarts in the process of growing your small business. Now, when we talk about the why, and this is really important, traditionally African-American entrepreneurs have always grown businesses and provided opportunities, services, products, and employment within our own communities, okay? We basically cultivated our own spaces, our communities, and our neighborhoods. Here's a wild fact. African-American women, specifically Black women, represent 42% of all new women business ownership. That's three times our share of the entire female population and 36% of all Black-owned businesses. So we have very high levels of education and attainment, coupled with overcoming barriers to corporate and government advancement. Those situations have prompted African-American women and African-American entrepreneurs to pursue entrepreneurship, and we've really become a very viable and potent economic force. However, we are still dealing with a lot of barriers. Access to capital. We're working through this whole process of social capital and also dollar capital. And we really, in some cases, lack mentorship and advisors. And so I would suggest that wherever you are on this journey, you basically want to take a look at your why. You want to take a look at starting up and or growing. And please recognize the small business resources through the SBA, and specifically we're a federal agency, they have to be not only explored, but they have to be utilized. It's almost like an invisible network. We've got a lot of really good resources that are available to assist you, okay? So as you can see on this slide, we're talking about the fact that you're gonna look to make some really smart and informed choices, okay? And we have SBA resource partners that can help you develop your business plan, that can help you work through these financial statements and your projections, and that can help you walk through this process of improvements and networking and making contacts. Now, specifically leaning into the business plans, what we recognize is that they are the foundation of any business. What you should look to develop would be a business plan along with the 30-second elevator pitch. You're going to look to pull together digital tools such as social media presence, development of a logo. And all these tools will help you so that when the opportunity presents itself, you're able to speak with a lender, you're able to work through a partnership, a joint venture, and or to grow your business. And in talking about business plans, I'd like for everyone to recognize that there are several types, okay? There's a lean business plan. A lean business plan is very much so associated with startups. There's a traditional business plan that you may have seen in business school or as through a template or an example. There's also what's known as a two-page business plan. So there's a lot of different types of business plans that are available. Some of the common elements in putting together a business plan are going to include the description of the product and of the service. Perhaps your business has a value proposition where you've recognized very specifically that you can bring a product or a service to the marketplace and you can do it in a more efficient manner or in a more effective way deliver a service. You want to take a look and work through what's known as market analysis and or a sales strategy, okay? With a market analysis, one of the most important things is where are your various channels? Where are you looking to put this information out to the market? That might be digital. But in addition, what is the market saying? Where is it going? Where has it been? You also want to take a look at your revenue streams because what's super important for small businesses, you can market all you want to, but you got to have sales. The fact of the matter is sales pay the bills. You also would put into your business plan or include information related to your organization, perhaps your LLC, perhaps you are a corporation, whether it be an S corp, perhaps your sole proprietorship. If you have any key management people, or if you're a sole proprietor, okay, but you bring expertise in the form of perhaps your degree and or your experience. Related to financials for a business plan, what's super important is there's all different types of financials. In some cases, small business owners will present financial statements, perhaps they're established, and or they may present some projections, and or their business plan may include a funding request. But what's really important is that a business plan is the foundation of your business. It's a map. It's a living, it's a breathing document, okay? Now let's talk about just briefly where to find them. Some ideas. You can find a business plan. If you're looking for some ideas, take a look at score.org. That's score.org. You can take a look at their library. They have a number of different types of business plans listed. You can take a look at the SBA's website, which is sba.gov. And if you take a look under Write Your Business Plan, we have quite a few templates too. And then also, I've included an SBA Illinois resource guide that will drop into the chat. And you can take a look there and look at a checklist, and it'll provide you with some of the key points related to a business plan. And that includes the traditional and the lean startup. What I think is super important now is to share with you some additional information related to some resource that are available to small businesses. And this is across the country, but very specifically within Illinois, there is what's known as a resource partner network. And this is the way to think through it. SBA is a federal agency. Here in Illinois, we work with the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity, and we work with SCORE and a few other resource partners that I'm going to run through very quickly. And again, this information is very detailed in the Illinois Small Business Resource Guide, and we're looking to drop a link to that so that every attendee can take a look at this PDF document. You want to hold on to it, but you'll be able to locate resource partners that are within your community. The other way to find local resource partners is at sba.gov/local-assistance. So one of the most important things to take a look at is at what point are you at? Because that will help you define what type of resource partner is right for you. So if you're a wannabe, if you're aspiring, if you're thinking through it, if you're looking for business advisory services by which you have the opportunity to speak with someone, okay? You would look to SCORE. Here in Illinois, there are actually there's five SCORE chapters, but there's three that are in Northern Illinois. There's the Chicago SCORE chapter, the Lake County chapter, and the Fox Valley chapter. Okay, they are providing online mentoring and counseling assistance. And they have a team of African-American SCORE counselors that are culturally sensitive. They're aware of concerns and or issues. They're all across the Chicagoland area, and they are addressing the needs of small business owners through counseling sessions, mentoring, which is free of charge, and also with webinars. And they have an action pack set up for Black History Month, so you'll probably see them across a number of different platforms. There are small business development centers. There's approximately 42 that are in Illinois, but within the Chicagoland area, there's approximately 13. And you've probably heard of them. You might be aware of them within our communities, whether it be the YWCA, whether it be a Chamber of Commerce in Bronzeville or in Little Village. There are small business development centers that will provide assistance to you. Again, if you're looking to start up and or to grow, and or if you're looking to participate in training, small business development centers can assist you with growing your business ideas. Women's Business Development Centers, also known as WBDC. There's actually two locations. There's one in Chicago, there's one in Aurora. Again, they provide comprehensive training and counseling. They provide business advice. And here's the key, the last listing for Ascent. Ascent is an online training that is available to small business owners. The six journeys are modeled after sort of Salesforce journeys by which a small business owner may say, I'm interested in getting access to capital, or I'm interested in contracting, or I'm interested in marketing. And you work through an online process by which there's a curriculum that's specific to your need and you get business assistance. Ascent is very well positioned in also working with a mentor and or an advisor. Ascent training is free. The majority of the information that I've shared with you related to SCORE, definitely free. The Small Business Development Centers, there may be a slight charge, but I have not seen one recently. So I would suggest to you also that that is a good resource and it is free of charge or low cost. And then of course, the two Women's Business Development Centers. And for gentlemen that may be on the line, just recognize it is equal opportunity. The Women's Business Development Centers advocate for women business ownership. However, men also can get access to those services. If you happen to be a veteran, there's a Veterans Business Opportunity Center, which again works specifically with veterans. And I share this information with you because we get a lot of calls and people will state immediately, I'm interested in this or I'm that. And so lots of times we will relate to the community that we consider ourselves to be part of. So if you're a woman, you may want to work through certifications. If you're a veteran, you may look for assistance through veterans channels. So what we've attempted to do is to make certain that we have these resource centers that work with entrepreneurs and provide this assistance based upon where they're at, what communities that they relate to. This is just a brief pick of the Small Business Resource Guide, and just recognize that that should be dropped in the chat. Here's our information related to the Illinois District Office. The direct phone number is 312-353-4528. Because we are working remotely, if you find that you have questions and you want to go into detail, you can also send an email. We have a very active email box by which we're sorting and making referrals, references, and responding back with materials and information. Now, just briefly, I want to talk about access to capital. And I'll keep this super brief because I need to make certain that I'm staying in the time limit. We have what are known as SBA-backed loans. They tend to be bank guaranteed loans. We also work with quite a few micro lenders that are certified. They provide direct loans to small businesses, $50,000 and under. For larger loans, there are quite a few lenders within the Chicagoland area, across the state, and across the nation that participate in our SBA guaranteed loan program. And there's all different types of loan packages and products. There are private investors that work with small businesses through our SBIR, which are known as Small Business Innovative Research, and our small business technology programs. And then they also work with small business owners through our capital investment programs. Okay, those tend to be much larger deals, but that funding is available. There's research and development awarded funds, that's through innovative research. And then there's also surety bonds for small business owners that are interested in participating in government contracts. There tends to be a responsibility for approximately $150,000 and over on government contracts where the provider, the contractor, needs to be bonded. And so we provide surety bonds to small business owners. I mentioned the microloans. There's three active microlenders that are here in the Chicagoland area, and they work with small business owners and provide some of the smaller loans that can be extremely helpful to small business owners. Let's say you're a small business owner and you want to participate in farmers markets across the city. Quite a few of them will look for a microloan and they will approach a microlender and get approved. So here's all the different reasons why people would look to obtain lending funds from a lender, from a microlender, from a bank. Usually it deals with the purchase of equipment and or inventory, and there's assistance that's needed, and there's all different types of products and services that are available, okay? So I mentioned the resource partners and the business plan. I'm gonna skip forward and suggest this. If you're in the market and you're actually searching for funding, you can go to sba.gov/lender-match to obtain funding. Here's some basic information related to the five C's of credit, which it sounds like you've covered previously. Character is cash flow. And character is lots of times why small business owners will initially approach a micro lender for a smaller loan to grow their borrowing capacity. We'll take a look at cash flow, collateral, capitalization, and conditions. This is some information about SBIR, STTR. I mentioned surety bonds. This is what's really important. There are some small businesses that are growing through federal contracting. And again, at sba.gov/contracting, you can get additional information, okay? We have some specialized programs by which small businesses can become certified. And with those certifications, they are better able to secure contracting dollars from federal agencies. That's the best way to describe the process. Procurement Technical Assistance Centers, if I had not mentioned them, if you happen to be a small business owner that's really taking a look at some some aspects of technical and or scientific standards or concerns and or packaging. We have what are known as procurement technical assistance centers, PTACs. They help with certifications and the rest. There are 8 in the Chicagoland area, in Illinois, and specifically 4 are in the Chicagoland area, including the Women's Business Development Center. This is the last comment that I wanted to make for right now, which is related to disaster assistance. So, you know, we're 3 years into this pandemic, and what SBA is charged to do, along with FEMA, is provide disaster assistance. So I'm certain quite a few of you have heard about the EIDL, which was known as the Economic Injury Disaster Loans. There were advances, there were loans that were provided. And so SBA will step in when there is a disaster, whether it's physical, geographic, if there's tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, and also economic disasters, and provide assistance. And then we book those loans directly to our loan portfolio. These are direct loans. Then finally, I wanted to just share this with you, and I think this is really, really, really important. As we're 3 years into this pandemic, I wanna encourage you to do a couple things. You need to enroll in some classes, whether they be webinars or workshops, whether they're online, whether you look at an emerging leaders class or maybe Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses, all these classes are free of charge, okay? Whether you step into a Small Business Development Center training class, whether you utilize Ascent, which is the online training platform for women, you definitely want to take the journey to invest the time and the effort. And it appears that you are today because you're on this webinar. I want to encourage you to make certain that you network, that you get answers to some of the questions that you may have, that you tap into the resources at every level. At the state level, through the Small Business Development Centers, the state actually has an African-American market manager. His name is Mr. Simpson, and he works with Black businesses across the state. They've just recently completed a survey by which they're asking small business owners to express their concerns. We're going to go into more detail as we walk through the Q&A, okay? And we'll be able to answer some questions in the fireside chat. And in addition, I want to encourage you, if you find that you have some questions, you may give me a call. You see my information, it's listed here. I can tell you that I have a commitment to business development and growth period. We make a lot of referrals. We try to provide small business owners with contacts so that they can get answers to the questions that they may have. My whole point is you always want to get to yes, whether it be yes related to your loan, okay? Whether it be yes related to your business plan, whether it be yes related to your network, so that you can move your business idea forward. So with that said, again, I want to say thank you to everyone. I want to pass the mic back. Excuse me, I do have one other comment. I also want to just recognize just briefly that the next presenters, AGB, they are actually SBA award winners. And I'm delighted to know that they are following up with me and that we're gonna have the chance to address the audience and some of the questions that you may have in the process of building your small business. With that, I wanna pass the mic back and say thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Very, very, great information that you provided with us. So thank you so much for taking the time to give us a great overview about business opportunities in the space and all the resources that you provide. Everyone who's on the call, we will be, like Carol said, having a Q&A in just a few moments. So please, we've seen a lot of your questions come through. So please continue to drop them in the chat and we will get them answered during our Q&A panel. All right, next slide, please. All, please welcome John Griffin Jr., CEO, and Dr. Denitra Griffin, President of AGB Innovative Security Solutions. A nationally trained full spectrum security and cyber expert, John Griffin Jr. founded AGB Investigative Services Incorporated on April 13, 2001 with his wife, Dr. Denitra Griffin. AGB offers expertise in all aspects of security, including physical and cyber. It's the largest African-American owned security firm in the country and award-winning company. AGB Investigative Services is missioned to eliminate economic inequities by delivering training and smart security services that protect people, property, and data. AGB employs over 1,100 full and part-time security professionals, particularly minorities in underserved areas in 20 states across the country, with offices in Chicago, Seattle, and Ohio. AGB means always giving back. Its nonprofit, the Always Giving Back Foundation, is dedicated to disrupting the cycle of poverty through workforce development, financial wellness, and philanthropy. An authority in security and risk mitigation, John Griffin Jr. was trained by the Department of Defense, Department of Homeland Security, and the United States Secret Service in computer forensics, and he is a certified forensic expert witness. The president, Dr. Denitra Griffin, has a rolling 20-year commitment to business strategy, leadership development, and social responsibility. Their combined skill set has led the business in aggregate revenues of over $100 million within the last 3 years, with steady growth margins over the national average. John Griffin Jr. is a 34-year active member of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. He holds a Master of Public Administration from Roosevelt University and a BS in Commerce from DePaul University. Dr. Griffin is an active member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, Chi Omega Omega Chapter, for 11 years. She holds a bachelor's degree in business administration from Loyola University and a master's in early childhood education from Roosevelt University and a doctorate in educational leadership from DePaul University. And the cherry on top, with all the success and all of these accolades, they will be celebrating 28 years of marital bliss this year, along with their four beautiful children. All, please help me welcome John and Denitra.
Good morning.
We're going to play the video first.
That's why I believe holistically, in all my heart and soul, that nothing is impossible. You got a guy, John Griffin Jr., right here, born in Inglewood, single mother, seven kids. I'm the oldest boy. I got a 12 and 13 AC test. And this company, under the leadership of me and my team, get top secret clearances. We're able to travel internationally and travel to do secret jobs. This company. And that's why AGB is going to be a $1 billion company. It's going to be global. Because can no one tell me I can't do anything? And we're going to help our people to come across AGB to help them develop to be great men and women. I don't want anyone to feel where I felt at 19 years old. I was ejected. I think it was framed. Something to my thoughts. I bet on me. I bet on John Griffin Jr. I bet on myself.
John and Denitra, if you are on mute, we are unable to hear you.
I think they got dropped. They just re-entered. So give us one moment, please.
Can you hear us now?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so we apologize for that and sorry we don't have the savviness to put the back screen back up, but I think what it requires us to do more importantly is to share the message. And so if we can go back to the slide that allows us to reflect a little bit on our journey. I hope that you were able to hear the video and hear the passion that was expressed through our visionary leader, our CEO, John Griffin Jr., who was also my husband. But what we want to share with the audience that is more important is that AGB is not just a business, it's a movement. And initially, when we decided to find AGB, the initial goal was to create generational wealth. We had quite a few children and understood that the salaries we were making in our respective fields just wasn't enough to support our family. But as we continued to work the business and we're going back to the president actually speaking, talking about service and Ms. Carol actually talking about your why, it wasn't until John and I realized that we can use AGB, our movement, as a way to demonstrate our purpose. John's purpose is to transform. Denitra's purpose is to teach. When those two collided in the context of AGB, it became a ministry and the floodgates opened. So people look at John and Denitra and ask, how is a couple like this able to grow a business this large? John comes from the south side of Chicago, born in Inglewood. Denitra comes from the south side of Chicago, born in the Morgan Park area. Graduated from Finger High School, which was one of the worst high schools back in the 80s and still struggles today. Took me 10 years to graduate with an undergraduate degree. By the age of 30, I was married with four children. How are John and Denitra able to secure clients such as the largest social media website provider, the White House, Microsoft, Amazon? And the secret ingredient outside of the magic that we bring is our intent, which is service. Service to our staff, service to our clients, service to the community. It's all about the growth and development of people. And that's how it all began with our name, AGB, Always Giving Back. So AGB began in our home. If you can go to the next slide to show the picture of our home, where it began, the journey. And John, you can share the story.
Wow.
I'm sorry. John and Denitra, I apologize so much for interrupting, but can we ask you to turn your tablet so that you're not sideways? There you go. Thank you so much.
All right. So the journey, well, that was our first home in the Roseland community, believe it or not, in 2001. Denitra and I, you know, we have four children. As always, we would go to work every morning. And even today, she calls me. So we get in the car. I take two kids. I go left. She go right. And every morning we listen to Cliff Kelly. So those of you on the call don't know who Cliff Kelly was. He was a former alderman. And he also was a VON personality. And we were talking about trying to come up with a name for the business. So there was one guest on the phone. It was a Black woman, forgot her name. But she kept saying, you have to always give back. You have to always give back. You have to always give back. And she was so passionate about always giving back. So at that moment, I phoned Denitra and she said, I'm just going to call you. Because we have our ride, we put the kids off, we go to work, and we have our talks on the way to work every morning, religiously. So when she said, I was just about to call you, I said, I have a name for my business. She said, me too. And I said, what is it? And then we said it together, Always Giving Back. So we knew at that point that the business was covered, that we knew we were in agreement of the name and the purpose. So that's how the story started, right there at that home, in the basement. And that home right there, that little Georgian, Denitra surprised me one day. She actually painted a room for me, my den. She got my business phone set up and she had my business cards. And that was the first office of AGB.
So when we think about how we began, it really began with sales. And it took us 2 years to actually secure our first client. And within that 2 year span, we just didn't sit on the business. We actually solicited our services and became a subcontractor on larger accounts or events that we were unable or weren't properly positioned to do in isolation. So people would actually come to our homes and we would handwrite checks and give people their payroll. We actually keep the case where we would keep records of all of our employees, keep records of all of the checks that we received and all the checks that were written out. And so that was just the patience and tenacity that we had in growing the business. It was incumbent upon us to make sure that we created some type of thumbprint on the services that we offered and made people aware of what we were doing. And so as the work product began to be more sophisticated and as we desired to grow, John quickly learned through resources that were just previously mentioned about how do you uniquely segregate yourself from other parties. And what we realized was the importance of certifications.
That's correct. So the Sister Harris that preceded us talked about 8A certifications. She is correct. Listen, people, certifications does not mean you're going to get a contract. Does not mean that. But certifications really set you apart. It says that you've been vetted. You are who you say you are, and it allows you to narrow the pool that you're competing against. It is a good tool to go and solicit, because on the SBA, it's been very helpful. She's right. SBA has been a great partner, AGB. In fact, our first loan, business loan, was at the SBA. And when we started to grow, we needed capital, so SBA was there to assist us. But you must understand, being certified does not guarantee a contract. But it is helpful because most businesses want you to be certified because you've been vetted. So that's a very good point. MBE, Minority Business Enterprise, DBE, Disadvantaged Business Enterprise, GSA Schedule. Certifications are huge. It is a good way to grow your business, but it does not guarantee you contracts. I want to make that point.
We also, John was also able to take advantage of the great programming that the city offers, which really helped kind of pivot his understanding as it relates to business. While he was doing those things, I had the advantage of actually working in the school system. I actually worked in a bank. So I was getting firsthand experience on how big businesses and big institutions actually run. So you want to talk a little bit about your experience with Goldman Sachs.
So Sister Harris mentioned before me and Denitra that the 10,000 small business, I was part of that class in 2012, which was the inaugural class in Chicago. It really taught us how to be a business owner. And not just, you can only run a business on passion. You got to put some skill to it. You know, the old folks said, at some point, you got to put some feet to your prayers. So that's what. So Goldman Sachs was a very good 10,000 small business, very good class. It was a 6-month class. Taught us everything from reading financial statements, becoming bankable, understand how to negotiate contracts, understand how to build and price your product or service. These are all important, but they are not inhibitors. So when you start, you got to get out there. You got to understand your product, your service. So I don't want people to be afraid, like, wow, I got to know how to do all this. You should. But if you don't, go ahead. Go out there. Yeah. Jump into it.
Our journey really is a non-traditional route.
Very.
There are some individuals that really think when you decide to become an entrepreneur that you're solely working for yourself and you're putting all of your time and energy into that, that vision.
Right.
And there are multiple ways of doing that. That is not
the way, it's a way.
That's right.
What worked for John and me, because as we were trying to grow the business, we still had four children.
And jobs.
Full-time jobs. That's right. And so that's right. The business started in 2001. At that particular time, I had three children. And so even after a fourth one was born, but AGB was our side hustle for many years. And that's it right. wasn't until 2011 when the business had just grown at such a significant rate.
That's correct.
With a healthy number of employees that John had a choice to make with his primary employer and AGB. And at that particular time, he made the choice. He decided with a little apprehension that he would go into AGB full time. And it was the collective intentions behind both of us, because when you decide to make a huge decision like that,
that's right.
Some entrepreneurs aren't thinking this way, but you have to think about healthcare.
Especially with children.
You have to think about healthcare for yourself, healthcare for your kids. Mm-hmm. You have to think about retirement. Because now your shift is focused, instead of you being contingent, your retirement being contingent on an employer providing those resources, you have to be creative about how you're going to provide those for yourself. And so with the business, with John going into the business full time, I was carrying the insurance at the particular time. The business grew astronomically because he was able to give his full self to the role. We had a full office. Our third office was right there in the Beverly area, and we stayed there for a number of years. In 2014, as we saw that the business continued to grow with John's presence, the infrastructure was not going at a parallel rate as the revenue. And so because of my experience with leadership and development, with business strategy, with innovation, I had to leave my job full time and come work for the organization. But that was done with a lot of consideration, very thoughtful intent, because we had to make sure that the business was able to afford our way of living, having these four children. And so when we talk about the business growing and infrastructure being important, none of that means anything if you don't have clients.
That's right. That's right.
And in 2016, I would say was one of the biggest game changers for us, where we scored a tens millions of dollar contract. And that really was the turning point for AGB. So all of the rest of the story, you can kind of find us in the digital space because there's a lot out there. We're blessed to have over 1,100 employees. We have offices here in Chicago, which is our headquarters, one in Seattle and one in Ohio, which John and I visit frequently. But before we leave, we just want to share a couple of tips that the general population may not share with you. Next slide, please.
Bet on yourself and your vision. Now, this is very important. You're going to have many people come to you and tell you it's not going to work. You're crazy leaving your job. But you have to believe that you can do this. I know it sounds cliche-ish, but there's an old cliche that does say this. It says, in the beginning, the man upholds the vision. But in the end, the vision upholds the man. So you must conceptualize and believe you can do this. And you can. It's scary, but you must do it.
Be bankable. So what we mean by that is you cannot grow a business unless you have a relationship with a bank. Whether your clients are other businesses, whether your clients are consumers, you have to have a relationship with a bank. And the key to having a successful relationship is with a bank is to track the revenue that's coming in and to track the expenses that are going out.
A simple spreadsheet would do.
A simple spreadsheet is sufficient. You may not have the resources to go buy an app or a service. because you want to reduce your costs, but you need to successfully track, even if you have to go back to paying everybody with a check. At least you're able to track your expenses that are going out, because banks will need to see that. And that's what they use as a baseline in order to gain you access to capital. I would also suggest is having a plan. And so although John and I did not start with a bona fide
business plan
that laid out all of the components.
I had zeal, I had grit, I had desire, I had an idea. And men, I kind of abstract. And that's why she's good, because she's very structured. Okay, you got to bring it in. You can't go to the moon yet. So let's bring it in and make some steps. So that's very important. And part of our plan was to establish certifications to make sure that when we approach companies for business, they can see that we are certified, that we are NA certified, that we have an MBE certification, that we are on a GSA schedule, that we can do things so they know we've been vetted and we were who we say we were.
And write those goals down. And so as we've grown the business, of course, we have a four-year strategic plan. We evaluate our plan every year. It is a living document. Our leadership team, we have monthly meetings where we look at the plan, because you want to make sure that you're moving towards the business priorities, and everyone in the company or in your admin staff are aware of what the plan is. But when I think about plans, I also want you to pay close attention to who are you selling to? Because you could have the best plan if you don't have a plan for your customer, whether it's a consumer or whether it's business. So are you doing B2B or are you doing B2C? And how are you going to get that sale and sustain it over time? Do you reach or go for multi-year contracts? When you have a consumer, are you interested? How are you going to maintain that momentum so you keep them coming back? Do you have a subscription model? What is your sales business model to attract and retain your client? And then last but not least,
relationships and network, very important. People do business with people they like, they know. So that's very important. And the sister, your bachelor's spoke earlier. She talked about service and giving of yourself before you receive. And that's networking. People think network is you said, give me, give me, give me. But it's giving of yourself. How can I help you?
That's right.
What can I do for you?
That's right.
And when you do that, the universe will reward the grind, reward the benevolence.
Absolutely.
So that's very, guys, I know it sounds sometimes like it's pie in the sky.
Yeah.
But give of yourself.
Yeah.
Service.
Yeah. So if it's someone that you want to meet or get to know better, position yourself in a way that you can offer a service to them. Oh, I noticed that you may be looking for someone to do marketing for you. Let me offer you some pro bono, blah, blah, blah. Or have you thought about using this as a resource? Or, you know, come and reach out to that person that you're trying to connect with by giving of yourself before you pull and start asking of them. And so I do want to end with a story that helped us learn this lesson. When we talked about our home and the office that I had created for John, there was a landline, an actual phone there. And we were at a gala.
Nobody's gonna tell that story.
I have to share. And then we'll close out. We were at a gala, and this was the time when past President Barack Obama was running for U.S. Senator. We knew that he was teeing up for the run.
Right,
we had the opportunity. We were at the gala. We were just introducing ourselves to him, and we were talking to him and explained to him, you know, his platform and that we were excited for his run. And so John gave him the business card. Barack called the phone. Barack called that phone and he did call back.
I didn't know he was going to be Barack. I'm like,
He did not call back. So years later, it's true to follow up when there are leads, make those relationships, definitely tap into that network and be of service to yourself. I mean, give of yourself before you add something of others.
Can I say one more thing, Dr. Griffin?
Well, it's time. So here
we go. Okay, well, great. Failure. Failure is a part of the process. You're not going to wait all the time, but all you need is one yes. God bless.
Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much. That was amazing. Thank you, John and Demetra. I mean, wow. I loved everything you all shared. Such an inspiration. I have so many nuggets that I'm taking away from the conversation. But passion, skill, prayer, got that. And follow up, because we don't want to miss any calls from the Obamas. I got it. So again, all, if you have any questions, please drop them in the chat. We will be moving shortly to the next portion of our program, which is a Q&A portion. But before we do that, we're going to take a small commercial break. And I would like to bring Madam Vice President on the call to have a brief statement.
This is truly exciting. I'm looking forward to the discussion. But before I do that, I have the pleasure of recognizing Teresa Dunbar Garrett, who is the Central Region representative to the International Program Committee of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. Welcome, Teresa.
Good morning or good afternoon to all members present and all of our exciting panelists and presenters. I was here in the morning and here in the afternoon, and it has been nonstop excitement and good information. I'm very pleased on behalf of Madam Central Regional Director to congratulate you. All of your programs are stellar. I cannot tell you how I have enjoyed your work over this past 6 weeks or so, just incredible. So keep doing what you're doing. Let us keep winning. And thank you for the wonderful, wonderful work in our communities. Remember, we win because we connect, we collaborate, we serve those who no one wants to be bothered with. And that is why they are going to remember your name. Thank you so much, Madam Vice President, Madam President, for the recognition. But the recognition is really yours as you are serving your community. Let's keep winning. Thank you.
Yes, keep winning. Thank you so much. All right, I am going to yield the virtual stage over to the one and only Melva Singletary, who is going to lead our panelists and speakers into a panel discussion. So please all welcome Melva and our panelists and speakers back on stage.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. I do appreciate the opportunity to pivot into our panel discussion. I am Melva Singletary. I will be your panel moderator for this portion of our program. I want to thank you both, John and Demetra, for sharing all of that information about your business and how you pivoted into owning your own company. And thank you very much. To our virtual audience, if you have any questions, please submit them in the chat and one of our committee members will retrieve them from there. And we did receive some questions in advance, so we'll begin with those that were submitted. So let's get started. The first question is for John and Demetra. And we would like to know, how do you effectively build a team that believes in your vision of your business?
So that happens over time. And I think it's constant. It's a constant reevaluation to ensure people are sitting in the right seats. And it begins during the interview process, because you want to ensure when we're hiring on our leadership team, it's evident if you're applying that you have the technical skill set.
That's right.
And so what's important to us is the behavior. How are you committed to the mission? How do you serve? Because when you're sitting at the leadership level, leadership is really about the development of others. So it's important to us that, yes, you have the skill set. Yes, you have the capacity to do the work. But we also need to ensure you're the right person sitting in that right seat. You have the right spirit, mm-hmm. the right intention, mm-hmm. and you have a servant leadership mindset. And that's constant reevaluation. I always tell my team that culture will kill strategy any day.
That's right.
And if you do not submerge yourself in the culture of AGB, I may have to invite you out. Simply because you can get security anywhere. It's what we do in the security business that helps retain our talent. So it's important that you are aligned to the mission, the core values, and you believe in service.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. The next question is going to be for you, Carol, and it's regarding what are some benefits from creating a business plan outside of creating structure and being able to use it for borrowing purposes?
Well, I think business plans, when you set one up, they help you communicate your goals. And a lot, excuse me. I think what's super important in understanding your market is if you communicate your goals and you're focused on your strategy, then as you're working through your milestones, you're able to measure and say this works. The other thing is that a business plan is basically like GPS. So it's agile, it's going to change, okay? But it's definitely part of the foundation by which you speak to what your business is about. And it can change based upon as your business grows and or who you're communicating it to. You can take portions of it and utilize it to speak to a lender. You can take portions of it and speak to, much like your mission, to your employees, or you can take portions of it and communicate to other small businesses related to who you are. So I think the best thing about a business plan is that it communicates your goals. And the other thing is, I think it's really important, it's like a GPS.
I love that. It's like a GPS. You have to know where you're going. So thank you for responding to that question. And the next question is for John and Denitra. What are some most effective ways to promote a business? And for those who are starting out their entrepreneurial journeys. I think you're on mute.
Oh no, I was just saying, we're just arguing back and forth. We just had a little argument. She's like, can anybody else tell you, baby? I said, I know. But I was thinking that you guys have an advantage, social media. Is tremendous. Best way to promote right now is social media. That's a form of outbound marketing and with passion. You got to have passion. If you don't believe in your product or services, no one will. Mm-hmm. You got to be passionate about it. And you got to have, you know, this is, you got to be in it. Mm-hmm. But I would say social media is the best way.
Yeah.
Because you use QR codes and all that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. And the generation, I mean, the generation to date is just super innovative, which is why we're very intentional about the group of people that we have on our team in that space and consultants that we use. And then it's contingent on your target market. So if you are marketing your product or services to consumers, then you know what popular social media websites you need to focus on.
Yeah.
And it's based on age. And then if you're doing business to business, which is what John and I do outbound marketing to, LinkedIn is underrated and undervalued, and it is key.
Yes.
And when I talk about the lead social website provider, which is our client, that connection came from LinkedIn. So do not underestimate the value of LinkedIn, particularly if you, for those of you that are still looking for jobs, I'm going to say that, but also for businesses that are trying to solicit their service or product to another business.
TikTok. I like TikTok.
Oh, yeah, you do like TikTok.
TikTok is powerful.
Yeah.
Those 59 seconds are powerful.
Yeah.
Short videos, everybody can see, powerful.
I agree. Thank you for sharing that. That insight. And Carol, I know you mentioned it earlier during your discussion, but can you give us just some steps on what is a good business plan or what does that look like?
If you go into business and you're providing a product or a service and you recognize that you feel a need that exists in the marketplace, then probably one of the best places to start with a business plan is to list your value proposition, okay? as far as you're going to look to make a statement about the unique value related to the product or the service that you provide, that you bring to the marketplace. And then from there, it's sort of the basics of business, which you can step into providing some financial information, providing an initial overview. You can speak to perhaps key resources and or activities and or even partnerships, okay? Are you working with suppliers? Are you working with manufacturers, subcontractors? Again, you can speak to channels as far as these are the different ways that I'll speak to my customers. Financial information is always interesting with the business plan because a lot of people don't want to share it or perhaps they don't have it. So there's different types, again, of financial statements that can be involved with your business plan where you can step through financial statements, projections, and or perhaps your business plan is you're presenting it to some lenders so you have a funding proposal, okay? I think all of those things are important. I don't think that you have to have a business plan to start a business. John mentioned that. But you certainly at some point want to write down your value proposition. You want to take a look at some of those key partnerships, and you want to take a look at sort of all of these elements that you're bringing together to move your idea forward related to your business.
Awesome. And Carol, did you want to say something about that? No, okay. So Carol, we also have a question regarding the first year of taxes when there is no income, but a lot of expenses. How do you, or what advice do you have for entrepreneurs in this space?
I see people do two different things. You know, on the Schedule C, your schedules, so basically if you're a wage earner, which means you get a W-2, okay? Or if you receive a 1099, and the fact of the matter is you have a household, okay? Then more than likely, you're gonna file what's known as a 1040. And with the 1040, you can file what's known as a Schedule C. And on that Schedule C, you can list those expenses related to that business enterprise. Now, I know some people that have stepped into saying, well, I'm incorporated and I wanna file an 1120. And that's possible. But the thought would be for most people that are starting off a small business, a Schedule C, by which you're able to identify all of the expenses, the outputs that you put into this business entity. Okay, it's an attachment to your 1040, by which you may still be working and you have a W-2, might be the appropriate way to consider filing.
Thank you. And what's your thoughts on borrowing from a credit union versus a bank? Someone wanted to know, is it that credit unions don't have enough funds available as much as a bank, or what are your thoughts?
That's an open question. So I'll say this. I think that anytime you operate, I think it's really good to have an association with a credit union, period. Because I think you need different lending sources for your household. So I'm going to first speak from a consumer standpoint. And a lot of that has to do with credit unions. Traditionally, we're associated with our places of employment, and therefore, or there was some common denomination, and therefore we were getting approved in credit unions a lot faster than we ever got approved in banks, okay? So I think that credit unions have super, super value. Now, I don't know that many credit unions that do small business lending. And it's not that they haven't been invited to participate in our agency programs. They have been. They just are focused on their marketplace, and their marketplace tends to be their members. And therefore, with members, the initial issues that come up are transactions, checking, savings, from there, maybe a car, personal loans, and maybe mortgage lending. But there's not that many credit unions that are actually doing a lot of small business lending, okay? So I think it's good to have a relationship with a credit union. I think you should have membership in a credit union. But when it comes to lending, Banks are not the only answer. Financial technology companies do a lot of small business lending. There's a lot of different other ways to get access to funding too.
Wonderful, thank you. And this question is for John and Denitra. When you have so many commitments to family, small children, a new small business, sorority and fraternity life, give us some insight on how you manage your time and how do you remain organized?
I didn't. I'm telling you, I was just sharing with a friend. It's like all a blur to me because when you're in the moment, you just kind of do what it takes. I have adopted this phrase by Bob Iger, who was the past CEO of Disney. And he said, as a business leader, you have the relentless pursuit towards perfection. The relentless pursuit towards perfection. And we know that we are not going to be perfect, but you have the relentless pursuit towards it. And I think that is what, that was my pulse. That is what kept motivating me and my husband. We knew that what we wanted, we knew what we wanted for ourselves. We knew what we wanted for our children. We knew what we wanted to do for the community. And so being organized was key. I have four children. So I used to have a grid. Like I had a grid on who does what on Monday and Tuesday, and where does this person go? And then as the kids got older, they were able to help each other and help me. But it was a lot of work. I have my husband and I both are spiritually rooted in our faith. You will find many African-American entrepreneurs who are and give credit to their success to their faith. And mm-hmm. so it's nothing better than going through the cumbersome work of raising a family and a business with my partner. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Another thing we did was we took the children with us as much as we could in terms. So all our four children know what it means to serve and know what it means to give back. They've been raised in a business, they understand entrepreneurship. So they went to Hampton and Morehouse and Spelman, and they always say, yeah, I'm gonna do this, but I wanna be in the business. I wanna have my own business. Because businesses, it creates wealth and freedom. And with a profit, you could transform communities and our people.
Wonderful. Okay, HBCU family, I love that. I appreciate you sharing that too. We also want to know about the business side regarding structure of your business. How did you maintain it? Did it ever waver? Did you ever make any changes that were critical?
Absolutely. Well, one thing I was, Sister Harris talked about, you know, AGB is an S Corp, subchapter S Corp. So the struggles and the changes in business and how you're supposed to, we've made money, we've lost money, things have happened. So you got to calibrate, you got to be very nimble, you got to be very spontaneous, and you got to be resolute. So our business has, our leadership team went from, you know, 2 to 12. And now we're talking about doing different regions, Southern region, in the Midwest, the Southeast, and things like that. So we have to plan, and do we need, what's the point where you need a branch office? What dollar amount and this and that? So things are always changing, but yes, you're gonna have to expand and contract as your business grow. Yeah. And keep in mind what I said, sisters, is that, you know, failure is feedback. And along the way, you know, people want to understand Denitra and our glory, but our story, it wasn't all peaches and cream, you know, but she never, ever not believed in the vision of AGB and her husband. In fact, when I lost faith in myself, it was my spouse who called me a coward. It was my spouse that said to me, and I repeat, she said, every morning we see you make prayer. You get up, make prayer. And now that things are rough patch with the business or whatever, you are, you know, you're shirking under your, under the weight. And she said that we are watching you, your children and your wife watching you. So y'all know, y'all tell a black man that, y'all, I'm like, what? That be Jack. I said, you must don't know who I am. I ain't no punk. Let's go. Let's go, you know, but So there's a lot of contracting and restricting and, yeah, and this.
There, and there's a lot of ebbs and flows, and you experience that as a business owner. But what mm-hmm. you do, you look at it as an opportunity to learn. And so
failure's feedback.
You're constantly reading, growing, associate yourself with associations. And so be a part of organizations that are specific to your industry. For me, I'm a part of groups that, you know, are C-suite women, multicultural. I'm part of groups where you have just Black business owners as women. I'm a part of groups that are Black businesses. And then John is a part of different security industry associations. So you want to continue around yourself and associations and people so you can continue to learn and grow. And even talking with entrepreneurs, their thought partners, they share, you share problems and you share resolutions.
And I'm gonna tell you this lastly, my fraternity brothers, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, have been with me through ups and downs. And those people, because in my fraternity, they are alpha businessmen on all different levels that I can go to and say, man, have you ever experienced this? And what about this? How'd you do this? So that's me as well.
Wonderful. I'm glad you all have a network that you can lean on in addition to each other, right? So we understand it is wonderful working with your spouse, but can you share some challenging aspects of working with your spouse? I know iron sharpens iron, right? So Denitra, can you describe some challenges that you endured?
Absolutely. No, I'm kidding. You know what? The good thing is that
I don't know why I'm here. I just got here.
I do call myself an entrepreneur by default, actually, because this was history. But my husband and I are friends. We are. And just like with any friendship, you may have disagreements. He's very strong-willed. I'm strong-willed. But I do understand and remind people in my office, and if they're on the line, they can attest to this, that he is still my CEO. And so there is no way AGB can be AGB without the vision that came out of his mind. And so he gets deference for that.
But after that, she runs it.
I was about to say, typically I do get my way. And there aren't many problems, right? Happy wife, happy life. But my husband trusts me. He trusts my judgment.
Yes.
He trusts my experience. He trusts my knowledge. And as I do with him, when there is contention, because sometimes there could be, and there has been, one of us just decide, hey, we'll go your way. I trust you. Let's roll it out. But I have to trust and agree. Like I have to commit. Mm-hmm. I may disagree, but commit. And so if I disagree, I still have to be all in as he would be for me.
But you know, there's really haven't never been too much of that. You
it
know,
really has.
Almost 21 years, you know, I can count on maybe two or three fingers. You know, it's like, you know, it's usually she want to fire somebody, but I have to save
not
the
true.
Person.
That's not true.
Well, I do appreciate you all for sharing that as well. We want to get into what it was like pre-leaving your full-time job. So how challenging was it to actually work a full-time job and birth your company?
Yeah, it was very challenging. Yeah. It was very challenging. And when people ask me like the secret, I really don't have because I think that my commitment as a mom was extremely important to me. The success of my children, what I did not want was to be this highfalutin couple and then my kids have been thrown to the wayside.
That's right.
My children are a direct reflection of our parenting. And so I would not compromise that. So did that mean that there was no such thing as work-life balance for us?
Nope.
It didn't exist.
Don't exist.
And so when you're trying to build a business, and sometimes my husband would spend more time, like he would have to go get training out of the state and be gone for 5 weeks. So that means Denitra's left here with 4 kids, taking this person to gymnastics, this person, you know, to wrestling, this person to dance. Yeah, it was a lot. And I had a great support group. good girlfriends. My mother-in-law helped out immensely. But it was a lot. It was a lot. And so it was my ability to manage time, you know, my nurturing relationship that I have with my children, the importance of them knowing the significance of helping and working together as their core four. All of those things were instilled to just try to help, like we all in this together. And so for all of us to benefit, all of us have to help out. So it was a lot. It was.
Yeah, but
it's no such thing as work-life balance, right?
It isn't. And so because when you're reaching for particular goals at a particular time, something is going to get more attention than the other. And so, you know, and we had to work through that because I knew what my husband was trying to do for the family, his contribution to the family as a man. They want to provide and protect. That's what defines their manhood. And so I had to understand as a mom, you know, this man is trying to provide and protect, but we got these four kids. How do we reconcile that? And it was constant negotiation, communication, and figuring it out as we go. Because I just can't be the only one driving the minivan and got four kids in the car. No. So it was a lot of negotiating. You be the coach for the T-ball, you know, while Jabril is in his primary years, while I'm traveling across the country with Nigeria in gymnastics, but constant renegotiation and about reconsideration of schedules and time.
Okay, thank you. Carol, can you provide us with those types of certifications that businesses may need again?
I'm going to suggest that with certifications, and this was mentioned before, that what's really important is not so much the cert, but actually who's buying what you're selling, and that's part of the marketing plan. So what I'm getting at is that certs are very, very, very important to open up marketplaces and to present a small business to buying agents and to work through procurement. But in addition to the certs, what's super, 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 super important for small businesses is if you step into any government platform, whether it be city, municipal, local, county, state, federal, what's really, really important is, are they buying what you're selling? Because if they're not buying what you're selling, then you're basically marketing to someone, or you're pursuing a cert that may not be impactful for your small business, okay? So I think that's super important. But with that said, there's MBE, which is Minority Business Enterprise, tends to work with the state and across the county. There's DBE, which is known as Disadvantaged Business Enterprise, which originated through the Department of Transportation, was used with FAA and quite a few of the federal agencies, and is also very much so recognized. There's the 8A certification, which is part of the SBA Small Business Code, which provides assistance to small businesses by which they're able to get technical assistance with a business opportunity specialist, and then compete with for small business with federal agencies. And then sometimes, depending upon the specific local government unit, they may have some additional certifications. Not all certifications have what's known as reciprocity. So in some cases, if you're working with the county or the state, they usually accept 8A, but there are some other certifications that there may not be that reciprocity across the various levels of government. Okay. What I think is really important for women is to consider taking a look at what's known as WOSB, which is Women Owned Small Business. That's it.
Okay. Well, we're going to keep with you, Carol, for a minute. I have a question. It's a direct question. It says, mm-hmm. I have an LLC and my organization is not for selling products, but for being of a service to disadvantaged teenagers and homeless people. How do I expand my business to help more people?
Well, the first thing I want to say is it's the process of giving back that you should initially be recognized for. A lot of entrepreneurs, I want you to keep this in mind. You may have developed a trade. You may have a craft, or you may be university trained. And so you work for other people. And then the fact of the matter is you recognize that you want to take that skill and or that talent and work for yourself. That's one of the ways by which we step into entrepreneurship. And it's really interesting to see in our community because people handle entrepreneurship two ways. Some go for profit, some go not for profit, okay? And the not for profit, in each case, they have a passion, okay? It's just a passion. I want to bring this service to the marketplace. But a lot of African-American entrepreneurs step into the not-for-profit side. So you might say, well, if it's not-for-profit, they're not actually entrepreneurs. But there's so many similarities between the two related to the process of the service being presented, okay? Best case scenario, every aspect of quality control, being able to replenish inventory, which is effectively the services, and then finding different ways to be able to get it out to the marketplace. One of the things that I think that's super important for sort of social entrepreneurs and or the not-for-profit is to take a look at any type of key partnerships that can develop related to how they bring their service to the marketplace. And then I think it's really important to take a look at, depending upon how that social entrepreneur is scaling, and getting some classes. One of the best online free not-for-profit training classes is actually with Northwestern. You can participate in a cohort, you can participate individually, but the bottom line is you can take some classes and it'll help you better identify not just your market, but how you navigate through that market and how you deliver those services. I think the other thing that comes up with not-for-profits and delivering services always is funded. Sometimes you'll see not-for-profits do what I call two trains running, which means they have their not-for-profit service. This is what we're bringing to the marketplace. And then they may have something that they sell. And believe it or not, that's one of the models that's definitely used, believe it or not, in a lot of houses of faith, by which some of their leadership will take some of their speaking engagements and or the resources that they bring to the table, and they're actually able to get funding for that. And then they're able to use some of that funding related to their outreach, okay? Obviously, there's going to be ways by which people can get access to funding related to any aspects of, let's say, grants. And now these aren't government grants, but these are gonna be more foundational and or corporate on the not-for-profit side. So I think those are some of the ways to seek or to take a look at funding. It's a little bit more specialized, but there's definitely some manners by which entities that bring services to the marketplace and that are looking to grow them, okay, can definitely, if they're on the not-for-profit side, get funding and identify those markets.
Thank you so much, Carol, and thank you both, John and Denitra, for everything that you shared today. I'm sorry, Carol, you have one more thing to say?
It's all good.
Okay.
Thank
you so much. I do appreciate it. And I thank you for sharing everything that you shared today. With that said, I'll turn it over to Alexia Huggins, our chairman for the event.
Thank you so much, Melva, for leading an enlightening and inspirational conversation. And thank you again, Carol, John, Denitra, for valuable insights. I know I learned so much today and I'm completely inspired. Before we close out our event, we hope that you'll stay on just for 3 minutes more. We are at the end. I just have three quick announcements to make. In the chat section, we dropped the event survey a few times. So if you have just 2 minutes, please take our survey. We would love to know how we did on this event. So in the chat, please check for the survey. As you heard at the beginning of this program, this is part two of a four-part series that we will continue to build you up in your business adventure, and we'll make sure that you have the resources you need to continue to progress in your journey of entrepreneurship. So please save the date for March 31st for our part three series, where we will be talking about business budgeting and finances. We're going to have some powerful speakers again for you all so that you can continue to learn how to grow your business in a financial aspect. And we will be giving you some homework today. So please go on SBA website. We want you to come back to session three with your business plan and goals. So a draft of your business plan and your goals so that we can make sure that you have your elevator pitch, you have your, you know, ability to kind of quickly talk to people about your business so you can get you going. So after, next slide, please. So after that, we'll then have our May session to talk about networking and mentoring. Next slide, please. I'll now turn the program over to Lakeisha Dancy, Target 3 co-chairman, to leave you with a few remarks. Lakeisha?
Thank you. So this presentation was amazing, wonderful, and informative. And so on behalf of Target 3, Building Your Economic Legacy, Chair Debbie Williams and myself, co-chair Lakeisha Hells Dancy, I would like to thank our presenters, Carol Harris, John Griffin Jr. and Dr. Denitra Griffin for an excellent presentation, and thank all of you for joining us today. We hope to see you for sessions 3 and 4, and now we will have closing remarks via video from our Vice President, Tasha Smith.
Greetings, I am Tasha Smith, Vice President of Chi Omega Omega Chapter and the Imani Pearls Community Development Foundation. On behalf of our program target chairman and the entire committee, we would like to thank you for your participation in today's program, and we truly hope that you were empowered. Chi Omega Omega Chapter and the Imani Pearls Community Development Foundation takes pride in providing quality programs in the communities we serve in the areas of education, women's health care and wellness, financial literacy, the arts, and global impact. For more programs, please visit our website at chiomegaomega.org or ipcdf.org. And as a bonus, if you see our QR code, please click on it and donate today. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
That concludes our program for today. Thank you again for joining us, and we will see you next time.